If you don't believe that God has got his hands on this company, there's something wrong with you. Hey folks, and welcome to another edition of BTP Sports Talk Sideline to Sideline. I am your host, Mitchell Brock. And joining me on the panel today, to my right, Laredo's finest. Around these parts, we call him Riley Cooper, the one and only, Mike Tula. And we've got some special guests today. Joining us, we have got Dr. Sabrina Jackson, who is the author of He Is Not a Statistic, he being the young man to my left. Her son, Mr. Marcel Smith, who is a basketball player at Houston Baptist University and also an author in his own right. His book is called The Balance. Thank you guys for joining us.
Thank you for having us.
Absolutely. You guys are doing great things. We definitely want to get you guys on and talk to you a bit. Now, I didn't realize until I sat in this chair and started talking to these guys that they're from my hometown of Detroit. So that didn't hurt. That didn't hurt. Y'all know how I am. So, Dr. Jackson, yes. He is not a statistic. He's definitely not a statistic.
He's not.
Talk to me about, first of all, him.
Well, Marcel Smith is a 22-year-old son of mine, my only son. But when I became a single mother through divorce, people kept telling me that he was going to be in trouble or have violent issues or issues with the law, and I said, oh, no, not mine. And so people kept asking me, what did I do to create a Marcel Smith? And so I prayed about it, and God gave me 12 things, so I put them in a book, and there are 12 laws, and I call them laws and not principles, because principles are things you can take or leave.
Absolutely.
Laws are mandates. I know these 12 work because the product is sitting right next to me.
All right. So let's talk to the product for a second. Of course, you being from Detroit, talk to me about how you got all the way down here in Houston to attend HBU.
Well, I got to HBU through recruitment of the basketball staff. They came to see me during my senior year. They came out to a practice, and they actually never came to a game. They only saw me practice. And the coaches, they loved me. They had me come out for an official visit, and then they came back for me to sign my scholarship once I committed. So it was great.
Okay. Well, it looks like you're planning where you're supposed to be. The Balance is your book. Talk to me about The Balance.
So The Balance is the student handbook for the new generation, the younger generation coming up, or even college students, mm-hmm. athletes who are trying to chase their dreams, find success, but also they need to understand how to grow in those other areas as far as families, taking care of their body. It's also important that people take for granted.
Mm-hmm. Now, Marcel, being a student athlete, what inspired you, or what kind of drove you to, not many people write and publish a book, in college, especially when they, not only are trying to keep up with the scholarship, but also, practice the basketball.
Practice.
Or
practice?
Play basketball. Right?
We talking about practice, man.
I'm just saying. What drove you to write a book?
Well, I sat back and thought about all the times where my friends, I would get calls from friends or teammates who all around the country, we're all, chasing our dreams and we get to a place where we find out, is this what I really want, or what can I do to help those guys? And I would get a lot of calls because I was always the team captain on a lot of my different teams. And I would get calls, and it would be different situations, whether it be I don't necessarily know who God is, or my body, my knee is really hurting me, man. This is, you know, these trainers aren't really helping me, or how do I get better? And a lot of different situations, and I just thought that I could write a book and really help people.
That's really cool. Yeah. He's 22 years
22
old.
22 years old, exactly.
Carry yourself like you're my age, 30.
Yeah, almost my age. I'm almost 40. You know, it's just, yeah.
Pretty impressive.
You took the words right out of my mouth. It's hard to believe that this is a 22-year-old young man. I mean, it's just very impressive. Definitely transparency. His transparency, and I'm sure it has a lot to do with his upbringing. Because I was talking to Dr. Jackson and Marcel before the cameras came on, and I'm just going to put it out there. Dr. Jackson don't look like she play around. She don't sound like she play. So talk to me about raising Marcel Smith as a single mother.
Well, the first thing that single mothers really need to understand, and I really stress this in the book, is that you are never doing it by yourself.
Right.
You have to have a support system. Mm-hmm. So when I wrote the book, I had men who were coming up saying, I want the book because I want to make sure that you said the right things, because you can't raise no man. You don't know how to raise a man. And there were times that I didn't know what to do. There are things that he went through that I would never go through, mm-hmm. because he's a man, I am a woman. So I had strong black men to help me with him. So that was critical. We had a very positive, strong support system. But then also, I had standards in my house. Mm-hmm. For instance, one of the chapters in the book says to find out what their passion is, then use it to your advantage. Mm-hmm. So when he came to me around 8 and he wanted to play AAU ball, which I had to pay for, I says, well, in order for me to pay my money, you have to bring me a 3.5 or better. And he says, okay, no problem. So 6th grade, 7th grade, 8th grade, you know, he started 3.6, 3.7. But then he went to junior high school and started liking girls.
Mm-hmm.
And he brought me a 3.3.
Mm-mm.
I shut it down.
Mm. For 2/10 of a...
Yep, sure.
Ooh-wee.
Did. Shut it down.
Did I tell y'all she didn't play?
Laws right there. That's
law. So he had to go to practice. He had to go to the games, but he couldn't play.
Oh, that hurts.
And so...
That hurt, didn't it?
From that day to the day he graduated, nothing less than a 3.5. He graduated valedictorian of his high school class. And so I attribute that to hard work on his part. But then I didn't waver on the standard. Too often, we'll waver on the standard. Mm-hmm. We'll say things like, well, he's on punishment, but it's nice outside, and I want to go to the park. So, okay, you're not on punishment today. No, if it was punishment, we was all on punishment. We couldn't go outside that day.
So that's establishing consistency already. And you want to talk about, he's been on scholarship seemingly his whole life then, because that's a scholarship, essentially. Mm-hmm. Maintaining mm-hmm. a GPA so you can play.
Absolutely.
And I'm going to tell y'all something. She don't know it, but that is my mother sitting right there. It must be something with Detroit women. I don't know. That is lit. That's why I just keep shaking my head. That's my mom sitting right there. She sounds like my mother through and through. I went to DePores, as you guys know, private school. Cost $4,000 a year to go there, and this was back in the 90s. My mama told me straight up, if I pay this kind of money for you to go to school, you're gonna do what you're supposed to do.
Oh yeah.
And I did what I was supposed to do. I didn't get my first B until I got to high school. I was straight A's all the way through middle school. I got my first B and C in high school, and I cried.
A C.
And my mother was like, the next time I see a C on this report card, you're not playing football. She never saw another one.
I love her.
Yeah, she never saw another one. So that's a great thing. Now, how many of your friends have actually bought your book?
So far, well, the book just released May 1st.
Okay, that was last week.
That was last week.
Okay.
So, yeah. But friends, people have been buying and shouting out and doing different things, so I'm pretty sure that a lot of people will get a copy, a lot of my friends.
Absolutely.
They have reached out and said they want to support, and they've supported by sharing with other people from their places around the country, from Ohio State to Hawaii.
From where?
Ohio State, my best friend.
The state of Ohio?
Yeah.
Because we don't mention that here on the show. Who brought him here? No, I'm just kidding with you, man. No, but so speaking of which, I was just going to kind of segue into tell everybody where they can get the book.
You can order the book at marcelsmith.com. And yes, go up on the website and you can find endorsements from the book, a little bit more information about me, and you can purchase the book there as well.
Absolutely.
Different quality, quantities.
He tried to give me one, but I won't accept it because I want to go and buy the book and support this young man. Dr. Jackson, tell the mothers where they can get a copy of He Is Not a Statistic.
He Is Not a Statistic is available on Kindle, on Amazon, if you want it on your Kindle, or at my website, SabrinaJackson.com. Again, SabrinaJackson.com. And I think you can get it on Marcel's website, too. Do you have it on your website?
No.
You don't?
I'm thinking you probably will after that.
He will. And his will be available on mine as well.
Of course, of course. Tula, you got anything else for him?
Oh, it's just very inspiring. I feel like going to write a book now.
I can publish it for you. Mm-hmm. I do have the publishing company.
Networking. That's it. That's it. You got to network. Well, I tell you what, guys, it is definitely a beautiful thing what you guys are doing. Now, let me ask you something else, Marcel. Basketball. We haven't even talked about basketball yet.
Okay.
He's like, yeah. I mean, when are you talking about basketball, man?
It's a sports show. I knew I was going to get a question about Floyd or the playoffs, something.
Okay. I don't know how much time you got, but we are doing the NBA segment. If you want to hang around, we'd love to have you.
Yes.
Now, we were going to do NBA NFL draft next, but if you want to stay, we'll do the NBA segment next, and we'll break you in. Y'all got time?
Yeah. We got time to
do that. Okay, bet that. All right, now let me ask you this, though. How are you doing in basketball?
How am I doing in basketball?
How are you doing in basketball?
How are your statistics
How's basketball going for you in general?
Basketball went great. I just finished my career at HBU. I started for 4 years. I am the number one free throw percent. I have the leading free throw percentage in our program history. I am top 10 in assists and all time, D1 and NIA, and I am number one in 3-pointers made since at the D1 level for HBU University.
You should coach Dwight Howard on his
Yeah,
that would take a lot of work.
Give him a little bit of that heart too. Yeah. Shots fired. No, so did you have any aspirations of playing pro ball?
I'm still in the works of figuring that out, but that is a high possibility that I'm going to do that.
Okay. All right. Hey, man. Definitely, definitely. Well, hey, folks, we definitely got to take a break here. Dr. Jackson, we appreciate you coming all the way from the D to talk to us.
Absolutely.
Brother Jackson, who is going to hang around and talk some NBA basketball
with
us.
Marcel Smith.
My bad, Marcel Smith. That's Dr. Jackson, that's Marcel Smith.
Yes,
but hey, we'll be right back with some NBA talk. So this is Mitchell Brock for Mike Tula, Dr. Jackson, Mr. Smith. We'll be right back.
You know, and I'm so happy to be able to be hanging out right now with Dr. Sabrina Jackson, who is the mother of Marcel Smith. And thank you so much for hanging out today.
Thank you so much for coming out today. We are so excited about this book and what Marcel is making happen in the world. So I am just beaming with pride today.
Oh, I'm sure you are, because, you know, as moms, sports moms, that's what we do, is we beam with pride, because we know that after we have had to, you know, sometimes put our foot down on some of
the neck. Put it in the neck.
Yes, you took the words right out of my mouth. I was trying to decide, do I want to be politically correct on here?
And we're just gonna be real. We bring in the pain.
We definitely bring in the pain. So I just love you.
I love you.
So and we love Marcel. He's making us proud as mothers of scholar athletes.
Yes.
Being able to, from his perspective, share what's important. Because, you know, so often, you know, we could have wrote a book. You know, neither one of us could have wrote a book about what they should do as scholar athletes.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think what's so powerful is that once you go through a thing, then you can relate and you've real life lessons that you have gone through so that the other person doesn't have to reinvent the wheel. So to me, your test becomes your testimony. And so that's just what this book is. And so as I was reading it, because he wrote it all without me reading it, he didn't send it to me until it was done.
Okay, because, you know, I surely would have been like, if I knew my mom was an author, I'd be like, ooh, mom, can you check this out?
He would not let me see it. He didn't want my viewpoint on it. It was definitely all from him. And that's what, you know, as we prayed this morning, because, you know, today is the National Day of Prayer. As we prayed this morning, we talked about how the Holy Spirit is just in control. And because the Holy Spirit is in control, whatever, because he was saying in the prayer, it doesn't matter about the money, it don't matter about how many people come, just that people are impacted and their lives can be transformed. And there's so many young people who get the sports right, but they get the academics all wrong. Or they get the academics right and they can't seem to get the sports right. So when you have the balance, you can do it all.
You really, really can. And you know, kids like, or young adults like Marcel, they're wired in that way. And so you really, all we can do as parents is help guide it, because exactly, they're really gonna do what they need to do, because that's just how they're wired. And you know, that's what we, I think that's how we connected initially too, because we understand that type of mindset in our kids.
Absolutely. And it's so important as parents that we don't try to make them be who we think they should be. We should discover what their passion is, but then use it to our benefit.
Oh, okay. Most definitely, because I'm just saying, we need you to earn your own money.
Yeah.
So you can, exactly. And I'm okay with even buying your own house, but I have my own room and with my own bathroom and like my own wing. I'm good with that too.
Own wing. I can do it my own wing. Yes. So by the balance, I'm looking for a wing to a house.
With my sister girl, Dr. Sabrina Jackson, this is Coach Leah.
Hey folks, and welcome back. If you're not following us on social media, make sure you do so. We're on Facebook at BTP Sports Talk. We're on Instagram at BTP_sports. We're on Twitter at BTP Sports. And make sure you guys are subscribing to our YouTube channel, which is Bring the Pain Sports. We see you guys watching our videos, but the subscriptions help us more than you'll ever know. Once again, here at BTP, we realize that there is no us without you. So, rejoining me on the panel, I should say, Mike Tula. And as y'all heard in the last segment, a surprise guest for the segment is Mr. Marcel Smith. We're about to talk some NBA basketball. So, you know, this young man, you know, four-year starter and got all his records and stuff. We're going to break him in. We're going to see what he knows about basketball. So let's talk about it. We'll start in the Eastern Conference. We've got Atlanta and Washington all knotted up at 1-1. We've got the Bulls up on Cleveland.
Great series.
2-1. I know y'all saw D. Rose last night with that shot. Talk to me about that series, that Chicago and
That series is a long-awaited series because of D. Rose's health and his rebirth, as a sense. You couldn't be mad at that shot last night, because it was, even if you were a big, huge LeBron fan, it was more about being a fan of triumph, overcoming, you know?
Right.
So that was
right.
Big for the city of Chicago. And as an athlete, you know, you couldn't be mad at that shot.
No.
But Kyrie didn't really show up as much as we expected with Kevin Love out. So that played a big part in last night's game.
Not one assist. How does your point guard not have an assist in a playoff game? Are you kidding me?
He's not the point guard.
He's on
he's
the roster as the point guard.
He's playing
like
that
Russell
position.
Westbrook, huh? He's really a two guard.
Well, he got injured that, you know, first quarter with the right ankle injury.
Yeah.
And much like Marcel alluded to, he shot 3-for-13, although he was 3-for-4 on three pointers. Mm-hmm. And really, it was LeBron who was, you know, a maestro with the ball, just dishing. We had 14 assists. He didn't have a particularly well shooting game, but he made up for it for getting at the line. And this is going to be a fun series to watch. I mean, I love the fact that this isn't like a Indiana Pacers, Miami Heat type of series that we had several years ago, mm-hmm. or a couple years ago, where they're playing for the NBA Finals, a right to get to the Finals, and Paul George is talking about, oh, I want you to be my mentor, LeBron
yeah.
James,
yeah.
while
yeah,
I'm going up against you. You got Joaquin Noah and LeBron going at it. This is like a...
Who wants the competition? That's what
this
the fans
is like
are paying
98
for.
Knicks Heat type of...
They went 7 that year, too. Really? Yeah. Did they go seven games? That was 2 years ago.
I am loving the new commissioner because the way he's handling the physicality of the game now. It's getting real physical these few playoffs.
It's getting back to the 80s, man.
It's getting back.
Unless you're talking about the Houston Rockets, because you if you just blow or breathe on James Harden,
hey, he's going to
free throw line. So. But I love I'm enjoying this series. I like this series. I like the attitude. I like how everyone's showing up to play, the people that are needing to play. Well, except for Kyrie Irving, but that's his injury. But I'm enjoying the series, and I really don't. You know, going in, I owe an apology to Mr. Rose, even though in game two, you know, he didn't have a particularly well game, but he really is making the difference for the Chicago Bulls. Didn't shoot well, 10 of 29 or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But he is giving them a chance to win, you know, in this series.
And like we talked about on previous shows, even in our preview show, when we didn't even know how Derrick Rose was going to be, I had Chicago coming out of the East even without Derrick Rose. I thought they were going to be a better team in Chicago. Mm. And, of course, series ain't over. I mean, it's just 2-1. This is the thing about LeBron. The same thing I said when he was with Miami and when he was not so much with his first stint with Cleveland, but when he was in Miami, when he gets ready, when he makes up his mind to play, there's nothing anybody can do about it. The way he came out in game two, he just scored 22 points in the first half, just bulldozing people.
His aggression on offense.
Yeah, exactly. Offense. His aggression. Why does he refuse to do that every game?
I think that he doesn't have the killer instinct that we like to see in greats, right, that we see in a Michael Jordan, a Dwayne Wade. Mm-hmm. I mean, he doesn't have that on a consistent basis. You know, he shows spurts of it. He has moments.
He got to get
talent,
mad.
He can do that, but he is more of a he makes his team better.
That's true.
This team was straight up 10-day-old garbage last year.
I mean, let's 10 be days? Honest.
Yes. They don't have Kevin Love right now because of a cheap shot by Kelly Olynyk. They don't have him. Kyrie Irving is injured. It's
still missing Varejao, who's a big piece of what they do.
Yeah, but I mean, if you're relying on Varejao and J.R. Smith to return to have a shot to win, that tells you what kind of roster
you have.
So he.
These are great role players,
though.
They're great role players. They go on any other team, they'll be starters.
No, they won't. They weren't even starters.
Varejao was a starter, J.R. Smith. J.R. Smith was
the starter on a Knicks team that was never even sniffing the playoffs.
Well, he was always in the running for sixth man of the year.
I've always liked Varejao. Varejao does the small things.
To rely on him.
Yeah.
To rely on him on a day-to-day basis in the playoffs.
He won the sixth man of the year.
Didn't mean anything in the playoffs.
2 years ago?
he's too inconsistent. He can't be. The San Antonio Spurs, they have Tim Duncan. I'm just saying. Tim Duncan, you can rely on him. The Clippers, Chris Paul and Griffin.
Griffin. And those DeAndre Jordan.
Guys. And three guys you can rely on every single game to show up.
Those are superstars.
Now. It wasn't always with Blake Griffin now.
Jimmy Butler, you can rely on.
I think Jimmy Butler's probably the best player on Chicago Bulls right now.
Oh, he's definitely the key to them. Yeah, but unfortunately, LeBron.
He's been the X factor as much
absolutely.
As
he is. He's been consistent. He is the best player on that team. He's the best player on that team. Derrick Rose is the best talent on that team.
Right.
But
he's
up and down.
Right.
He has higher peaks. But Jimmy Butler's been there, but he can't guard. He's a great defender, but even you can see no one can guard LeBron. That's a constant issue.
No.
Like you were saying, he's got to find that fine tune where he can take over a game and, you know, pass the ball around like he was doing last night. I mean, that was really fun to watch.
So give me this. I really would have liked to seen this series as the Eastern Conference Finals. You know what I mean? But it didn't work out that way. The way to see who's going to win this series real quickly.
Cleveland. I think they're going to make adjustments. They're going to put They're going to put LeBron on Derrick Rose. LeBron on Derrick Rose. We've got to have a little bit of drama here.
Absolutely.
They're going to put LeBron on Derrick Rose. Last time we saw what happened, Derrick Rose couldn't do anything.
Shut him down, yeah.
And they'll take their chances with Jimmy Butler and the great J.R. Smith probably.
The great J.R. Smith. Who you got in the series?
I'm going to take Chicago.
In?
Seven. It's going to go seven games. I just think that over seven games, you know, they're going to wear LeBron down.
Yeah.
And if he goes to guard Derrick Rose, there'll be a lot of energy you're going to extend. And you're going to give Jimmy Butler a lot of free time. You know, you put Iman on him, that would be a better matchup defensively. You got to leave Iman Shumpert on Derrick Rose. That's your best bet. Kyrie, that's not playing.
That's exactly where I was going when you said that they put LeBron on Rose. At that time, the Bulls had nobody else who could put the ball in the basket consistently.
Right, but
now you got Jimmy Butler and you got Pau Gasol.
They're never making that switch, though, now. They'll make adjustments. LeBron's too good. I'm pulling for the Bulls to win. I just need to see it happen against, this LeBron-led James team.
So quickly, let's just brush over Atlanta-Washington because, let's be honest, nobody's paying that series any attention.
I'm paying attention.
Atlanta wants to go home, but,
They're
trying to go home, but
Wins that series and how many?
I think that Atlanta wins because of John Wall's hurt.
Yeah, that was it. I had Washington
He's not playing tonight, and so I think that'll be a pretty big difference.
I'm leaning towards Atlanta. Washington, they're not defending that corner three. Everybody on Atlanta can shoot. I mean, you have Antic or Antic, whatever.
NBA.
Yeah, he's popping threes on the corner like crazy. But at the same time. Otto Porter for Washington, he went 15-8-9 last game. Paul Pierce shooting 8 of 17. I can't count him out, too. Atlanta's that team that hasn't proven themselves yet, so I don't know who's going to win the series, but if you're going to hold the gun to my head, all right, I'm going to go with Washington. Yeah. I'm going with Paul Pierce, the truth, baby, that I'm sticking with him to the end.
Yeah, you are. You are a Paul Pierce fan. Now, I was the same way. I was Washington all day in this series. But without John Wall, I don't see it.
Even with Sessions putting up 21, you still don't?
He's just filling in points, man.
John Wall is the point. Let's move over to the West side.
Huge loss.
So, let's move over to the West side. Golden State, Memphis. Is actually a little bit closer than I thought it was going to be.
Oh, yeah.
I thought Memphis was going to – I thought their physicality would overwhelm Golden State. I'm not saying they were going to sweep them, but I thought their physicality would dominate Golden State. Talk to me briefly about that series.
Memphis is – they're a tough team. It's not going to be easy. You have – especially when you have two bigs who both can rebound and score. They match up well. Obviously, Mike Conley coming back helped them a lot.
A whole lot.
I mean, it was a stark contrast between the way the game flowed from game one to game two. How healthy he is, throughout the series, how healthy he can stay throughout the series, I think is going to be.
He was definitely rusty in his return game. Yeah. What you got?
He played great, the first game back. But I like the Warriors. I think this is a special group right now.
They're loaded.
But also the energy they're playing with, the way they're passing the ball, it's much like Spurs-like, but they're changing the dynamic of basketball through three-point shooting. Nobody plays basketball, and if you notice, they're not really running offense.
They're hooping.
They're using the energy of the ball.
They hooping.
And it's great to see.
Yeah.
I thought, like you said, the physicality would overwhelm them, but Draymond Green, alumni of the family,
He's a Spartan, I let him make it.
He's tough. He's tough and he's really been stepping up, in the rebounding category. And that will determine the series, I think,
him an inside presence and on offense, he can stretch it.
He's guarding. They even had him guarding Marc Gasol.
Hold that thought for me. We'll come back to this after this break. Hey, this is a good conversation, and we'll be right back after this break. Hang on.
This is Coach Leah, and I am with Marcel Smith. Marcel Smith. He's right here live. We are at his book signing for his new book, or his first book, because I'm sure you'll write more, called The Balance. And Marcel is a student athlete, a scholar athlete, as I like to call them, here at Houston Baptist University, playing on the men's basketball team, finishing your undergraduate degree in 3 years, and using 1 year of eligibility to start a master's program, earning your MBA. Is that correct?
Yes, that is correct.
So tell me what made you want to, first of all, pursue an MBA as opposed to some other degree or not even consider a master's degree at all?
I wanted to work towards being a better businessman and further my career after basketball.
Very good. Now, plug for my radio show, After the Whistle, which primarily talks about life after sports and even everything surrounding sports that does not happen, on the field or on a court. So I thank you for that. You will be coming personally to my show. Thank you for visiting yesterday as a radio, as a call-in guest. But no problem. Like,
I appreciate you having me.
Okay, but my turn to talk. No, I'm silly. You'll get to know that. So tell me, because again, how did you find the time to be a scholar, be an athlete, and write a book?
Well, we make time for what we want to do. So I had a vision, I made goals, and I stuck with the plan.
What was the vision? When did you get this vision?
I got the vision in high school when I got in trouble, and I saw that opportunity as an opportunity to change and help other people. So,
what kind of trouble did you get into?
Some other trouble I don't want to speak about. Just being young.
Then that's fair. I think, however, to acknowledge the fact that, you know, we always can bounce back from setbacks. I think that's always real, real important, and I'm sure that there's the anecdotes about that journey within your book.
Yes, it will help a lot of people understand the balance they need, even when they mess up or when things are going good, to keep things afloat, keep things all going well.
Well, very good. And I'm so proud of you. Check out this wonderful sign here, The Balance, Student Athlete Handbook for Successfully Managing Life with Sports and Academics. I'm Coach Leah. Bring the pain, sports.
On a long and lonesome highway, east of Omaha, listen to the engine of morning out his one old song. You can think about the woman or the girl you knew the night before. But your thoughts will soon be wandering the way they always do when you're riding 16 hours. There's nothing much to do. Feel much like riding. You just wish the trip was through. Here I am on the road again. There I am up.
Hey, folks, and welcome back. Sitting here with special guest Marcel Smith, Mike Tula. We're talking some NBA basketball. We left off talking about the Golden State Memphis series. So, finally, who you got winning that series and how many?
I got the Warriors in six.
Six? Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's a solid pick, Marcel. I'm gonna double down. Warriors six.
I'm gonna buck the system. I'm gonna go Memphis in seven. I'm gonna go Memphis in seven because I think that
I like their
and Golden State.
Yeah. I'm gonna tell you why.
They're tough.
I'm from the Bad Boys era. You too young to remember it, but the Bad Boys era. Physical basketball wins in the playoffs. That run and guns, the last run and gun team was that won a championship really was the Lakers. But the Lakers were also very underrated on defense. I just feel that when you got, like you said, two big men who are big, physical, can put the ball in the basket, play both ends of the court.
And Tony Allen locking down.
Yeah, I mean, I just think that over a series – now, if these teams played seven times in a regular season, I pick Golden State every time. But in a seven-game series, eventually they're going to wear those guys down. And at least one or two of those games, those trades are going to stop falling. Yeah. At least one game of series. It happened against New Orleans. At least one game, they're not going to fall.
Yeah, they just have to make sure those threes fall for four games.
Exactly.
Because it's hard to come back.
Two games are going to shoot back.
Yeah, it's hard to come back.
Two games.
Yeah. So, y'all got Golden State. I'm going to go with Memphis. Now, let's talk about the hometown team. Let's talk about the Rockets. You're smirking. So, you got something for me. Talk about this Rockets and Clippers.
It's ironic
series.
That we talked about physicality and we brought up the Rockets.
Right.
They just don't go in the same.
None.
But I got the Clippers. I think the Clippers will win pretty handily. I mean, Chris Paul is not even really fully playing. He played 23 minutes last night. I think that the Clippers are way too much there. They just beat the defending champs in a soulful series. You know, physical. They gave everything they had. I mean, their new owner was at sideline. You know, and they're ready. They're ready to go somewhere. You know, Chris Paul thinking like this might be my chance.
This is it. I think if the Clippers don't at least get to the finals this year, they're gonna start busting that team up. Now, by the same token. That high could sometimes work against you. You're so high from beating the champions, but
it doesn't look like it.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I mean. Sometimes you reach that high too early and then you fall. But on the other hand, you reach that high and you propel, and that's what it seems like they're doing. Now, are you picking them just because they're up 2-1 or because you think they're a better team?
I think they're a better team. I think they proved that game one.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh yeah. What, 16 points?
At home?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh man.
Yeah, that much like last year, the NBA Finals, you know, as is the case this year, it happened in the first round. Mm-hmm. Last year, it was Dallas and San Antonio. This year, it was San Antonio and the Clippers. San Antonio gave Game 7 away. They didn't go to Tim Duncan that last 3 minutes. I don't know why. Kawhi Leonard forces up a shot. Tony Parker should have pulled up on a fast break. Instead, he wants to get blocked by Blake Griffin, but I digress. there is no... Think about it from this perspective. They go from Chris Paul. Who does he have to worry about? I mean, Jason Terry.
Nobody.
J.J. Redick and Austin Rivers, he's making them look like superstars. Mm-hmm. I mean, J.J. Redick, he's looking like he's back in college. He's attacking, being aggressive. He just had 31 points. The Rockets, if you're a championship team, the Clippers, they got Chris Paul, Blake Griffin, and there's a big drop-off between, you know, the next person in line. They didn't have – Chris Paul, game one.
No.
You are supposed to win that game. Patrick Beverley, he's very good, excellent defender. They're missing him, but that shouldn't be a tit-for-tat loss in terms of availability and kind of players that you have.
Right.
Houston Rockets, they don't play any defense. Josh Smith lollygagging his way back in transition defense while Blake Griffin's going to dunk. They don't have the defense. They doesn't seem like they have the heart.
So who you got?
Clippers. Clippers, I got them, I want to say five. I'm going to go with six to be safe.
Yeah, I'm with you. I say the Clippers in six. So, Marcel Smith, brother, appreciate you joining us. But we got to take a break. And when we come back, we will be talking about the NFL draft. So, we'll be right back after this break.
Welcome, everybody. This is Bring the Pain Sports Talk, and I am in the MD Anderson Student Center at Houston Baptist University, and we are enjoying the afternoon with Marcel Smith, who has just written the book, The Balance. Check it out, The Balance. And I've got his dear friend, Z Mott, who has just bought her copy and had it autographed by Marcel. How are you, Z?
I'm doing well, thank you.
So, okay, so let's open the book.
Okay.
Open to the front where he signed.
Okay,
so both of us were just like, oh my gosh, that is so cute.
Yes, I really appreciate the inspirational message. Just like he said, I'm glad that our paths crossed. He definitely has a good message for student athletes and just a good message all around for anyone that's pursuing education and has other ambitions at the same time. So I definitely think that his book is something that is essential for athletes. So I definitely encourage anyone to go out to pick up The Balance because it definitely has some helpful information.
So helpful information, and I'm sure you will cherish this copy.
Yes.
With your own personal message.
Definitely.
Check out the message, y'all. Check out the message.
Personalized copy is always good.
It always is. And you know, anytime that you can have somebody who that you know personally take the time to pen something like this, it's sure to be cherished for a long time, don't you think?
Definitely.
Hey folks, this is Mitchell Brock.
This is Richard Walker, the great sports Morpheus with Bring the Pain Sports.
We're here at the 2015 Paul Bear Bryant Award presentation brought to you by the American Heart Association. Now for you BTP Sports fans who watch our show, you guys know we like to have fun and clown around and laugh on the show.
I want to talk to you for a minute about something very serious and something very near and dear, and that is heart disease.
600,000 Americans die each year from heart disease.
Just think about that for a second. The most populous game that you probably saw this year was close to 100,000 people. Multiply that times six.
Folks, that's 1 in 4, which is 25%. And a lot of people look at heart disease as a disease that kills men. Well, the statistics show that over the past 30 years, more women than men have actually died from heart disease.
600,000 seat stadiums full of people every year pass away due to heart disease. And a lot of those instances could be prevented. Things such as have living a healthier lifestyle, getting early prevention and detection.
So join us, BTP Sports, and the American Heart Association in the fight. The information is on the screen.
Bring the Pain Sports supports the American Heart Association in the fight to prevent heart disease.
Yeah.
How y'all doing? This is Mike Tula with Bring the Pain Sports here at the 2015 Shell Houston Open. This is the final day of the tournament, and we are winding down. Last year, we had an exciting finish. It was a playoff between Matt Jones and Matt Kuchar. Matt Jones ended up winning last year. Both golfers returned for this year's tournament. Matt Jones already being cut.
Matt Kuchar is 3-under for today, and other notable golfers at the tournament, Sergio Garcia, 8-under. Phil Mickelson is at 11-under. And going into the tournament today, Jordan Spieth, 21-year-old out of Dallas, Texas, was leading until J.B. Holmes was having a heck of a day, going 9-under for the day, pulling ahead at negative 17. Jordan Spieth, he is 2 strokes behind, and Johnson Wagner is also in the mix as well. It's going to be an exciting finish.
And we will keep you posted here at Bring the Pain Sports. This is Mike Tula, signing out.
Hey, folks, and welcome back. We'd like to thank Dr. Sabrina Jackson and Marcel Smith for joining us here today. So now, now that we got that out the way, let's talk some NFL draft. Y'all know we wasn't going to burn by a show without talking about the NFL draft. So Mike Tula's back, and joining us remotely again, we've got the great sports Morpheus, the one and only Big Rich Walker. Rich, you there?
What's up, fellas?
All right. So there he is. All right. So we had some surprises. We had some things that went the way it should have went. You know, we all knew that Jameis Winston was going top overall. But we had some surprises. I think the biggest surprise is where, in my opinion, where Mr. Mariota landed.
Oh, Tennessee.
Right.
Right. I'm kind of surprised that they kept him. I thought they were going to
trade bait.
Draft him, trade or something. But apparently not.
Yeah. Yeah. They're going to roll with him. And to skip down to number three, just yesterday it came out that the number three overall pick for the Jags, Dante Fowler, blew his ACL out very first practice, and he's done for the year. Big Rich, talk to me about that.
Devastating injury. You know, the first day of rookie minicamp, kid blows his ACL, he's done for the year already. This is going to be a big void that was supposed to be filled by Fowler, because they needed an interior pass rusher, and that was the whole purpose of them drafting him. So
yeah,
they're not going to reap the benefits of that this year. So I think they'll probably bring in some type of free agent to see what they can do to salvage their pass rush for this season.
Right. Now, looking at the list, Vic Beasley went to the Atlanta Falcons, which Vic Beasley and Dante Fowler were arguably, well, they were the two top edge rushers in this league in this year's draft, and we went back and forth on who was number one. So now you think the Jags are saying to themselves, dang it, we should have took Beasley. What do you think?
It's especially now.
Hindsight is 2020, of course.
And this is, they can kind of now Jacksonville commiserate or empathize with their in division rival. Mm-hmm. Because Clowney at least it's now they got their hearts broken right off the bat.
Yeah.
Texans were expecting Clowney and Watt, and after game one, first quarter, that went out the window.
Yeah.
ACL tear. So this at least gives them enough time to somewhat adjust.
Right. Try to, like Rich said, bring somebody else in or well, that's all they can do. You can't draft again. I don't know what else they got on their roster that they could move up.
They're probably going to keep an eye on Wilkerson from the Jets to see if maybe they're going to hold on to him or not.
Yeah. I think another big surprise here was Todd Gurley went to the St. Louis Rams. And early, I mean, he went number 10 overall. Yeah. Speaking of ACLs, he's coming off an ACL and to go top 10. Rich, what do you think about that?
I was completely blown away by that. I expected the Rams to either move that pick or, you know, you just drafted Trey Mason in the third round last year. You had Zach Stacy, who rushed for 1,000 yards the year prior to that. You know, I didn't think running back was a priority for the Rams. I figured that they would go with, you know, definitely a quarterback because you got I don't even know who the quarterback is. I know that Case Keenum's on their roster. Go Cougs. I think it's Austin Davis was the starter last year, and then they made the trade. They got rid of Sam Bradford. They got Nick Foles.
But yeah, Foles is going to be the guy this year.
Yeah, sure. But you know, we don't know what to expect from him. So I expected them to have at least a quarterback battle, and that, you know, that draft a quarterback. But that's the decision they decided to go.
I'm just impressed or surprised, shocked that there was only 7 quarterbacks drafted this year's draft.
Right. Yeah, in 7 rounds. That's unheard of. Let's also talk about quickly the Texans. and their first round draft, hometown Texans, of course, their first round draft pick was the kid out of Wake Forest,
right.
Kevin Johnson. What did you think about that pick?
Well, I was at the draft party, and the response from the crowd was a little bit lukewarm. I think because everyone was expecting them to go with an offensive lineman, and then second to that, a receiver. Obviously, they lost Chris Myers, their center, who was available every single game. So you would think that they would go address the offensive line, but they didn't at all during the draft. But it was a well-received, you know, once people kind of got to know and started to do more research on Kevin Johnson, you know, it's a good fit for them.
Right. Big Rich, your Cowboys, at 27, took Byron Jones, the cornerback out of UConn. What'd you think about that?
I think it was a great pick because, you know, first and foremost, if you followed any Cowboys football, you know that the biggest weakness that we had was our secondary.
Mm-hmm.
They did a great job addressing the defensive line to create some pressure. But, I mean, Brandon Carr is just absolutely pathetic. And Maurice Claiborne is a bust. We're just going to call it what it is. So it's time to start upgrading that secondary. And that was a great pick.
And one of the good picks the Texans got was in the third round, Jaleen Strong. He was projected to be a late first-round talent. To get a guy like that in the third round, especially when you have a need at wide receiver.
Right.
Great pick for them.
Right. And let's talk about the fact that the Cowboys picked up Lyle Collins, which was the kid from LSU who's being questioned in the murder of his ex-girlfriend. Rich, what'd you think about that pick?
Phenomenal pickup. I mean, you get a guy who was had a not only a first round grade, he was a top 10 grade, you know, by most draft experts, and he falls completely out of the draft because of this investigation. And you get him, you know, getting picked up as an undrafted free agent. So that was a great accomplishment.
Did you have something too?
Definitely going for talent. They already have a sensational offensive line. You can never have, as I'm sure you guys can attest to, enough offensive line.
Nope.
Help, especially when you're losing DeMarco Murray.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Rich's favorite running back. I can't repeat to y'all what Rich said. When we were in Vegas.
That'd be the uncut version of the show.
Oh, it was hilarious. Yeah, but
I think the Jets, they
had a great draft.
Right, because they weren't expecting Williams to drop.
Yep.
And, wow, if they can hold on to Wilkerson and Williams.
Yeah.
Jets defense.
So, in wrapping, tell me what team you think had the overall best draft.
Wow, I don't know. I would probably say, just from the standpoint of getting a franchise player, the Buccaneers with Winston, especially because they've been striking out like crazy with their quarterbacks, mm-hmm. and it looks like they got themselves a closer in him, and that can make a lot of difference.
Closer, ironic, because he's also a baseball player. Big Rich, what do you think?
I think it's kind of a toss-up to me. Of course, Cowboys had a phenomenal draft. They walked away with three players that are rated with a first-round grade, if you include the undrafted free agency period. But the other team that I think really flew under the radar was the Oakland Raiders.
Big time.
They walked away with some great players that are going to be a good fit for them. I think Amari Cooper is going to be a heck of a player for them and a good compliment to Derek Carr. So they're going to be sitting pretty.
You don't think Oakland – draft success, they don't really go
ahead. No, you don't.
Yeah, it's hilarious because no matter who you're talking to in Houston, anytime you talk about quarterback's last name, Carr, David automatically comes out of their mouth.
I'm guilty.
Everybody, David, I mean, Derek Carr.
I forgot to mention that they picked up our good buddy Gus Johnson.
Absolutely.
In Oakland.
That's right.
As an undrafted free agent as well. So shout out to you, Gus.
That's right. Go ahead and make the team, brother. Go ahead and make the team. But hey, folks, we got to wrap this up. We just want to touch on a few of the surprises in the first round of the draft. So for Big Rich Walker, Mike Tula, this is Mitchell Brock. We thank you guys for joining us, and we'll catch you next time. I came to bring the pain. I came to